So real estate investment became a part-time gig to me to really turn the tables on being able to do things that you want to do in life, spend time with family, retire early if you want to do that. So I looked at it as an alternative to your traditional 401ks, your other type of investments that you can make, where it's a little more risky, but the reward is there as well. So I wanted to have that balance in the portfolio. So outside of that, you know, I'm in the government contracting industry. So pretty stable industry to some extent. But for that, I grew up in the Northern Virginia area, born in D.C., grew up in Alexandria and Fairfax. I live in Alexandria now. So a lot of the investment will be in the Northern Virginia, D.C. area, but I do have investments outside of the area as well.
All right, so we're intentional with our success, and we have a good amount of people here, not too many. I will ask everyone to introduce themselves. Just 20 seconds, say your name, or your organization, and how can someone help you out?
And also their level of investing experience. Correct. So when we answer the questions, we know kind of what we're talking, talking to.
Intentionally say, I'm looking for this. So if you're a wholesaler, say, I'm looking to build my investor list. Start with you.
I'm Lawrence McKay. I'm a newer wholesaler based out of Woodbridge. So I am looking to build my buyer's list.
Excellent.
I'm not really new to real estate. Used to be an agent. Got away from the industry. Came back to it. So that's fine.
Sean Kennedy, Keller Williams, Kingstown, agent. Fairly new to real estate investing world. Looking to just build my overall team.
Linda Tyson. I'm an attorney and I'm looking to learn more about real estate investing.
Hello, my name is Emily Tassiana Bowie. I'm with Longley Foster and just wanting to learn more about the investing world.
Earl Anderson, contracting officer. I am also licensed. I'm looking for lenders that are investor friendly.
Kevin Wheeler with 123 Junk. We're help sponsoring today's event. I'll tell you a little bit more about us later, and no investing experience.
Gabe M. I'm just breaking into the wholesaling and rehabbing space. I'm looking to network with as many folks as possible, other wholesalers, rehabbers, contractors, agents, hard money lenders, everyone.
Go ahead, start, George.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Lisa Jones. I'm active duty military. I'm also in the process of transitioning out of the military. This is my first real estate investing meeting, so I'm hoping to network and to, you know, possibly get some mentorship, see some new faces, get my name out there. And I'm also in the process of getting my real estate license. So, and I was invited here by Angelia.
Angelia, Keller Williams, Kingstown. Agent as well as a wholesaler, and looking to, you know, increase my networking and build a buyer's list.
Julio Cruz, Keller Williams, Lake Ridge. Just looking to expand my understanding of investing and getting to know how to get financing.
Thomas Ariali, Home Savings and Trust Mortgage. Completely new to investing, so just looking to learn some information.
Sean Watson with Prosperity Home Mortgage. I was invited by Kevin Wheeler and a friend of 123 Junk. No experience in investing except on the mortgage side, so looking to learn kind of more on the real estate side.
Bill Connolly, C2 Financial Services, LLC. Originally did some landlord work, realized that was not a good place to be. Didn't like being marriage counselor, plumber, electrician, etc. So I went in, bought non-performing first and second mortgages, work out, resell notes, and then expanded that into private lending, trust deed, investing. My main objective for meeting people is A, meeting people, 2, building network. If you go out, it's amazing how many people you can meet, but a lot of them you like, some of them like you. And that works well. My objective is to get on distro lists for various different wholesalers.
Tracy Goins, Keller Williams Preferred Properties. I met your wife and you at a family reunion in New Orleans, and I have invested before. I work with investors and just want to get more of the financing of investing the smart way. Mm-hmm.
My name is Kia Hall. I'm also an agent at Keller Williams Preferred Properties. I was invited by Tracy because I'm interested in investing also.
Travis Lee, I'm also with Keller Williams Preferred Properties. Tracy invited me. My background is property management, so I did that for a decade. And after managing $100 million assets, I figured why couldn't I do it for myself? And so far, I've done two rehab deals with tenants.
David Atkins, my background is in contract management, and I am interested in additional real estate investment opportunities.
My name is Kari Brazier. It's kind of funny just listening to you talk up there about finding the right partner, and on top of that, you all being liquid, and then you all clicking. I have that. This is my partner, Mitch. Our company is Fire Strategic Partners. We hooked up about 7 months ago, put our heads together, put our money together, personalities and everything clicked, and we're 95% complete on our very first flip.
Nice. Congratulations.
So, you know, we're just here to find out how we can get additional financing from various members.
It's Darren Mitchell. I'm a resource manager for an agency at Beat. I'm also a realtor at Keller Williams Flagship in Maryland, over the other side in Roseville. We talked about our experience there, so we're just looking to grow our company at this point from here on out. And because she whispered to me and said, you need to just introduce me, so like speaking in large. This is my wife, Dina. She's also a realtor as well. And, you know, she also works for the FDA. So.
Good luck.
Hi, everyone. I am JJ Conway. I'm military transitioning, preparing for retirement. So I do a financial planning business on the side. I am also an agent out of this office, but my primary focus is as a financial management debt reduction wealth building. I have 4 rent homes, and the last one was a cash deal I just did in Baltimore City. And so we bought it, $6,000, put some money into it, got it rented out right before he was born in November. And so I really do like rehabbing. I like landlording. Well, I don't know if anybody likes landlording, but I find it rewarding as far as wealth building goes. And so I am here to network. I will be wholesaling in this area, but I like to operate in cash, so I can't afford to operate in cash in this area. So I'm interested in connecting with folks, building my buyers list, and then also connecting with anyone who likes to buy cash deals up in Baltimore City as well.
How you guys doing? My name is Devontae Dinkins. I'm actually an asset manager with the Minkini Group. I'm just here to network. I actually buy and hold and with multifamilies in Washington County, Maryland. So I'm just here to network. Learn some more about different financing sources.
My name is Tony Mooney. I'm with Coldwell Banker in Arlington. I just came to learn about this.
I am Nader Shirazi. I'm a real estate agent as well, working with so many investors, looking for wholesalers as well as lenders.
Hi, I'm Maurice Mbatler. I'm an insurance agent. I know AJ and the team, so I'm here to hang out with like-minded people. It is my dream and vision to someday get into my investment properties. I'm just here to feel the energy and get motivated for more.
Great.
Sorry I'm late. My name is Miri Tijana. I'm from Keller Williams campaign office. I was invited by none of you, by Facebook, so yeah. my wife and I went to real estate because we invest in retail as a retail investor, so that's why we're interested in real estate. So I'm here just to network and be open-minded, just to attend an investor gathering a long time ago, so started here. Thank you for holding.
A couple of available seats if you want to.
Sure. My name is Sam, part of the AJ team, best team in Northern Virginia selling real estate. Here with my team supporting, and here to obviously be with like-minded individuals like yourself. Appreciate it.
My name is Jamil Scott. I am here with my son.
with the AJ team, and I enjoy working with people like yourselves and meeting new people. Thanks.
Hello, sir. You like to introduce yourself?
I like the hat, by the way.
Thank you, sir. I'm going to keep the rain off that. Simeon Deskins, I was invited by Tracy Goins, and I was stuck in traffic coming all the way from Maryland, so I apologize for being late. Live in Bowie, Maryland. I don't know what else you want to say.
You have any particular purpose? Maybe you'd like to learn more, or you're...
Yeah, definitely. For, I've bought and sold like 30 homes before. I've did some self-financing. I've done a pre-construction. Camden Crossing in Baltimore. I just want to get back into swings. I got two kids in college. It's killing me, so I need to make some money. That's my purpose.
Excellent. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started on the interview. Two gentlemen here. And let's jump right into it. So, gentlemen, top three things you should not do in a rehab.
Buy outside of your comfort zone as far as location. I think that's the one thing that we've been very successful at is we kind of stick within our niche. When we buy in Northern Virginia, when we buy in an area that we really understand the comps, I think we always pretty much knock on wood. Turn out okay. When we start getting outside of our location, even though there are deals that make sense, number one, it's harder to analyze. It's a lot more heartburn. Those deals haven't been as positive as the ones that we've done locally, where we really know the market. So that's one.
So if you're going to rehab, not be an absent manager unless you really have someone you trust. I'd also say don't renovate without a plan or budget. It makes decisions go a lot quicker. Prevents you from being a bottleneck in the process.
So absent manager, the way we're fortunate enough where my father, I come from a family of real estate, so my father owns 50 properties where I'm from in Charlottesville. So I've seen him do a lot of his properties, and he's on his way to, he's just managing his properties. He's not really doing any more buys and flips. So we've been fortunate to have him come up, and we pay him a consulting fee to manage our properties for us. So if you can find someone who's, you know, what we call an old OG in the game, someone who's been doing it for a long time, who'd like to make, you know, between $5,000 and $6,000 per project, and all they're doing is just looking out, and they're there every day. That's worked out really well for us. We do understand that person is kind of hard to find because he makes a lot of design decisions for us as well. He really takes a lot of the guesswork out. But if you can find someone to manage your property while you're at work, especially if you have a 9-to-5, I think that's really the best way to go for us.
Excellent. I didn't know Alan was an investor when I first met him. I actually met him at a rehab that I was doing with a partner. He didn't even say hi to me. He just said, we need to talk. And then he walked off. But as I got to know him, definitely a great man to learn from. And
whoop, whoop.
So my next question is, how long have you been an investor?
I've been investing since 2002. So the first property I bought was a property I was going to move in, owner-occupied, but I bought it with an investment mindset. So it needed the basement to be finished. It was a HUD property. If anyone knows what the market was like in 2002, properties were really cheap. I bought it in Woodbridge. So my intent was to buy it, fix it up, and then pull the equity out so I can go buy another property. So my first true investment property was in 2002.
Correct. Yeah, I was about 13 years. 2003 was my first owner-occupied property, one I knew that I would appreciate a lot. In fact, I used that appreciation, the equity from that property, to finance the second investment property. So 2003, 2004 was my story.
Excellent. What are three traits that a new investor needs to have starting out? We have a lot of aspiring investors here.
I say I probably tailor it based on if you want to do buy hold versus buy. So if you want to buy hold, you know, as gentlemen, you heard gentlemen talk about, you got to have a stomach to deal with paying for tenants. You will have some. There's no way around it, especially as the market shift. So you got to be able to stomach the long hauls, stomach the ability of having to put people out when you need to. From a buy flip, you know, liquidate, being liquid. You know, you got to be able to have your money stretch and be comfortable with the risk of making the right decision in terms of what's going to market and sell your property. Don't be afraid to spend a little money to do that, especially from an infrastructure standpoint, even though you don't see it behind the walls, it's just as important, in my opinion. So you got to make sure those things are right. So having the wherewithal to make sure those things are done right and not be afraid to spend the money where it counts.
Excellent. All right. What methods do you use to get your deals now versus when you first started?
I think we both use equity from our primary residence. So some advanced tips. If you guys are married or if you're going to get married, make sure that you buy primary residences in one name or the other. Never buy them in two names. The reason why is because it allows you to be able to stretch a little bit further when it comes to buying assets. And banks kind of like to see people who have separate, even though you may be married, people that have separate assets. It's worked out well for my wife and I. So I'll buy one property in her name, another property in my name. One property in her name, another property in her name. If anyone knows, Fannie Mae caps you at four properties through a mortgage lender. So when I buy properties in both names, it allows me to buy four properties instead of if I jointly bought them, we could only buy four together. So that's allowed me to be able to use 20% down, very favorable financing when it comes to investing, and you probably can speak a little bit more to that scenario. My first was going to a bank to pull out the equity line of credit. I vividly remember going to Bank of America and saying, hey, I've got this property, I renovated it, I finished the basement, and they gave me a $50,000 line of credit, and that was enough to get me jump-started into the game. Now we do something a little bit different. I was very intentional about starting a relationship with a small regional bank. It was an introduction. I went to meet Chris, and he'll probably be here next month. We probably should get him here next month from John Marshall Bank in Arlington. And we literally sat down with him probably about 5 years ago and told him about our plans. And I don't think Chris would have taken me by myself, and I don't think he would have taken Willie by himself, but when we came together with assets and experience, it was something that I think that they looked favorably upon. So we were able to get a credit line that allows us to be able to take down properties, 14 days, access cash. You know, they want to see strong financials and they want to see some experience. But that a lot of that stuff is about relationship as well. So you know, I'm a big proponent in make your friends before you need your friends. So you can't go to a bank and expect them to give you a loan straight out if they don't have a relationship with you. You got to start a business account. You gotta talk to the. You gotta take the senior loan officer out to lunch. You gotta let him know what you do. You know, all those things are things that take time. So that's what we do now.
Excellent. What's one piece of advice you would tell your younger self when you started out?
I think for me it would be network more. Events like this and. You know, just like when Al and I came, you know, we knew each other in college, but we didn't connect till later on and just bumping into each other, talking about interesting things that we want to do. Right. You know, like you said, making friends before you need friends, and that's where it kind of led to. So wasn't doing or didn't realize the value of doing such earlier on. I really do now.
Younger self, enjoy your youth while you have the energy to chase deals, because deals take work. Like, to get real estate deals, it really literally takes a lot of work. You know, anyone who's done a rehab deal knows how many late nights you've been on the computer looking at properties, going by properties that you don't purchase, things that don't pan out. So really, when you're young, really like getting your hands like dirty, going in and out of a lot of properties, get to know your inventory, get to know your area. My young self telling my older self now, I would have bought and held more. I just, you know, when I look back on the properties that we bought and flipped, if we just would have bought and held all of them, we would still have the equity that we could pull out to do what we wanted to do. But that's really like buying and flipping is you can make money, but you build wealth by buying and holding. You know, so, you know, buying and holding is a strategy that, I mean, God knows where it would be if we, luckily the rates are still low, but the prices aren't.
Sorry. One thing I love about Alan is he looks at me as if I'm his younger self and basically give me that advice.
A little bit taller, a little bit handsome.
Like this much. Moving forward, what are the usual mistakes new investors make as an OG, triple OG?
Well, I'd say for us, or for me, on the buy hold side, it's picking the wrong tenant. Picking the wrong tenant because they may be the only one that's available for a certain period of time. And I got to get someone in here. Those can be problems down the road, especially with, you know, pick a room. There's people with credits all over the place. And I'll say the more applications I see these days, everybody's credit's bad. And that's okay, but you got to make sure you get the right tenants because it'll cause you problems down the road. Like I said, things happen. And also in terms of them maintaining the property. So don't be a rush to make a bad decision. So do your diligence, give yourself that cushion in your budget each year that if you're going to have a vacancy in your rental property, make sure you're comfortable with that cushion that you get the right tenant in there. I'll say on the buy hold side, it's that... buy flip side. It's the cutting corners. And it's a...
especially here in D.C.
Yeah, cutting corners. You know, even if the thing, hey, you don't really need the permit, you know. Fairfax County, perfect example. You know, we had a potential buyer come in and says, hey, did you get permits to put in this new stove? You just plug it in. What? Fairfax County, you go read the code. It says you got to have a permit. Really? So you call the county. Does it really say this? Well, not for electric, for gas, but it says it on your website. And so, you know, even though those little things are minor, you get a buyer who's particular. Maybe it's not the right buyer for you, but at the same time, make sure you know all those things based on the jurisdiction you're working in. And as we learned, doing more flips, you know, make sure you reimagine the space. You go into a really torn down property, can you really reimagine, you know, moving walls, where things will look. We've had properties where, you know, it was, you know, it's a townhouse, but it had two bedrooms upstairs and it had a joint bathroom in between. You know, just looking at it, it says, hey, if I put a wall in between, now I got two master suites that I can build. So, you know, really looking at how you imagine the property and what you can do with the space to start to build.
Hot water heaters in Fairfax County, you're supposed to have a permit. Didn't know that until a nosy neighbor told me that. Another mistake I think that young investors make is they're greedy. They have deals that could work, but they want too much when it comes to a partner that they're dealing with. You know, so sometimes like the value in me working with Will was that I limited a lot of the liability and we were able to learn together. His skill set brought something to the table that I didn't have. He was able to analyze a deal. Like, I'm real good at saying, oh, this looks like a good deal, but I can throw the numbers at him and he can say, okay, this is the actual ROI. This is a return on investment. And then I see a lot of investors who have great deals and they don't have the ability to be able to take them down and the deals end up going south or going to someone else. And because they wanted 50% on the deal, you know, no one wanted to touch it. Instead of just saying, okay, look, you know, you pay me a fee or, you know, you give me a small equity share and you get to, number one, do the deal. And number two, you get to learn. You know, so you know, there are young investors that are running across deals. They feel they're entitled to 50%. If you don't have the money, you don't have the experience, I just don't. I can't afford to give you 50% because my liability is on the line.
Excellent. And that's exactly how I got started. I took 15% equity in a rehab instead of being greedy and trying to get 50, as you said. So who's the number one person a real estate investor should be close to?
Say the money guy and girl.
Yeah, the money person. you know, a contractor that you trust. You know, I think you having a contractor that you trust, someone that you can call just to go into properties and give you quick estimates, is important. But the money's the most important. And if you don't have the money, then, you know, what are you really going to do?
Yeah, but like you said, it's where you get the money from and who you're spending the most of it on. If it's your contractor, and I tell all the time, it's the speed of trust and making sure they know what you like. But it's also those, as you're looking at contractors, you're trying to get multiple ones, you work with multiple teams, but you get a feel for who's good at what, where the quality is, and their attention to detail. And so, you know, that those things that you want to make sure are right. And so, you know, they do good construction work, but when it comes down to finish work, things, caulking and stuff like that, those little things make a big difference. So, you know, keep an eye on who does what well.
So I learned a valuable lesson from Willie. I don't know if you remember when I got mad at our contractors. And I was like, man, we can get somebody cheaper, man. And that's the conversation. I was, we can get somebody cheaper. We can get somebody cheaper. And Willie calmly said, look, is $2,000 really worth, number one, severing a relationship and dealing with somebody that you trust? And what ended up happening, I think we ended up getting another contractor that ended up fumbling the job. And at the end of the job, I probably would have paid more to the people that we had done business with for a long period of time. So just make sure that, you know, you can't cheat everybody. Like, people who are working, they got to make money too. And you want them to have a vested interest in making sure that your deal goes through. So, you know, sometimes you can't pinch everybody. So that was a very, very valuable lesson that I learned from Will.
I told everyone that education is a top objective of the meetup. So what is the top book a new investor should read, and what is the top book that maybe an investor who has some experience going to the next level should read?
You always give me to read so that you can.
I think it's Mind State. I think anything that you can, you can just, create a better mind state. Obviously, Millionaire Real Estate Investor, the Keller Williams series is a really good book. Hold is a really good book. And I don't know if it's very, I think people, we get caught up in the fact that we don't have time to read it from cover to cover. I think you should treat it as a textbook, so maybe you should take a chapter and just manifest on the chapter and just read it and highlight it and then go to another chapter and just kind of play with it like a textbook. Because when you start reading it all at once, you don't really have enough, you're not soaking it all in. So Hold, Millionaire Real Estate Investor is a good one. I literally just got a podcast. So I'm in a podcast. I don't know if you guys have podcasts on your phone. There's a podcast called Passive Real Estate Investing. That's a good one that I listen to. Who's the guy that we listen to on the way up to Baltimore?
Jay Massey
has another one. So, I'm always just listening to those podcasts just to get ideas.
What was the first one, sir?
Passive Real Estate Investing. Passive Real Estate Investing. So he's all about buys and holds. And then, I just kind of use those podcasts to just kind of flare out to whatever books they say they're reading.
Okay. What would you say is the top thing that you did to take your own investing game to the next level?
I'd say for us it was establishing that relationship with the banker, getting that bundle out. Not for speed of funding. It's a great resource for other contacts and avenues. And it allowed us to get to a different tier or market of properties from a value perspective.
Yeah, that relationship was key. Not necessarily for the money, but for the resources that he brought to the table. So we take him out to we meet with them either for a game, a ball game, or lunch, or I refer him other clients. And we really sometimes just sit down and just pluck his brain. What are you seeing other investors doing? Where are they investing? What successes have they had? What failures have they had? And we run all types of deals past them. So we're buying a multifamily building in Arlington, a four unit that we should be going to settlement on in a couple weeks. And he was like pivotal. Like, that was our first foray into buying a multifamily in Arlington. So to be able to like sit down with him and have him run the numbers and just someone that we trusted was, I think, it really like made us feel a lot better about the situation. So you got to understand those relationships sometimes aren't about money. Sometimes it's about who they know and the resources that they have.
One person I listen to a lot is Jim Rohn, and he makes a joke a lot that poor people should take rich people out to dinner and let them talk on and on. So when choosing contractors, how do you do that?
How do we find folks?
Yeah, I mean, you have some people that you work with.
Right.
My contractors I've worked with, and it's been trial and error, you know. You know, you bring your guy and crew to them, we'll get quotes, see who talks the best game from a dollars and cents perspective. But then, like I said, as you learn and you work with them, you get a feel for who you trust, who's going to deliver good quality, and kind of help you out. You know, they give you a break on one deal. Like I said, you got to take care of the next one. But you got to have, I'll say, a primary and a backup for every trade. So you got your general contractor, you got your plumbers, and you got general contractors who say they can do plumbing but really can't. And you got your electrical hooks, and you want to make sure those are done right.
Junk guys.
Those are key. Gotta have your trash out and ready. So it's a little back and forth, but like I said, you gotta have a primary, a couple options. You know, guys are always busy, sometimes you need them right away. And you got your stable folks that you have for your buy hold properties, and the folks you need for your buy flip. So, you know, you gotta know when time is your money. And how to make it work.
I think also talking to other investors and talking to, I think we've gotten a couple referrals from our lender, who's a general contractor that's done a good job for you. Watch out for part-time contractors because they oftentimes will do work when they're off, right? So we had an experience where we had a townhouse that we were doing, and townhouses are obviously connected. So he was coming in and doing a lot of this heavy lifting and his sawing and all his pounding when people were asleep on Saturdays and Sundays. So that's the best way to piss off, a nosy neighbor. So you need to make sure that you may get a good deal from your Uncle Rufus, but if your Uncle Rufus is working, and he may be able to do the work really well, but if he can only work on weekends and nights, that's not really conducive when you've got a lot of money on the table and you've got to get your project to finish. So just make sure that you get people that are full-time. I think it's vital.
And I'd also say have a good feel for what it costs and what the effort it takes to do some things. So then one of the things that's helped me as a real estate investor is my first primary home, I did a lot of renovations myself. I got a feel for what it takes to do. I know how to do it. And so when you're talking to contractors, they know you know what you're talking about. And you're not getting snowed. And, they're giving you a quote, a price, or effort more than what it takes. And so, garner respect with them. So if you get to the next deal, they know what you deal with, they know what you like. But I think that's important. So if you do have any skills in terms of understanding how to rehab works or doing it yourself, try to do some of those projects yourself if you have the time. Obviously, if you get more involved, your time becomes more premium. But if you can do that earlier on in your career, I would definitely suggest you do that.
Excellent. So, negotiation tactics to get the price down for a property.
Purchase price.
So, I do probably 90% of the negotiation. He negotiates the multifamily that we purchased, that we are purchasing. You can't squeeze every dime out of a seller. So there has to be like a fine line between them being offended by what you offer and you understanding what their bottom line is. So, even if you're dealing with another agent or you're dealing with someone where you're buying their home direct, really like trying to find that fine line between you getting a good deal and making it worth your while to either buy flip or buy hold. And then, where you don't feel like you're putting money on the table. It's by experience. How you ride a bike, you just keep riding and falling off. So you might have to lose some deals if you look at an MLS or look at a tax record, you'd be like, damn, I would have bought it at 175. But, you were hell-bent on staying at 150. So, just kind of finding that fine line. I think you just got to get into negotiations. I understand negotiations aren't a combat sport. It's really not. Like, you got to come to a win-win for both parties. So you got to find out what their why is. Why are they selling? Why do they want to get rid of the property? Is it that they need expedience? Do they need to get rid of it in a week? Do they want someone who's going to keep the integrity of the neighborhood? Did he just want someone that he just feels good about? You know, you just kind of got to feel where you know where the other side of the deal is. And you know, he had the relationship. We sent out letters, and then he got the call for the person he negotiated the deal with. And it was very important to have that cohesiveness with the person who initially called him. So just understanding the dynamics of how the relationship first started as well. So he did a really good job of negotiating that. I probably wouldn't have got that deal done. You know, and he had the patience and he had the, you know, the rapport to be able to get the deal signed.
Why are some investors average and some investors go on to have great success?
I guess I would say, I think it's about that buy flip. Those are looking for cash, and then there's a long-term wealth, right? And so you got to do what makes sense. If you get a point where you need to stack up cash, those things make sense. Then you can move into a different echelon of properties that generate more of a return. But being in it for the long haul, so when you look at a deal, you analyze and say, all right, what kind of timeline do I want to get my money back? So quick buy flip, yeah, you're trying to get it back in 6 months, you're going to stack cash, what are you going to do with that? The cash in the bank doesn't do much for you. But if you're looking for buy hold long term, it says, all right, you know, if I put money in the down payment, money in rehab, what's the timeline to get my money back? So if I get my cash flow and positive rent, you know, if I can do it in a 5-year period, you know, it's usually a good buy. Sometimes you can stretch that. Anything less than 5 years, in my opinion, is a good buy to get that back from monthly cash flow. And then a market where you got good rentals coming in. So looking at those deals where you can stomach, you know, the timeline of getting your cash back and getting back into the black. Because once you get there, it's all top side from there. As long as you maintain the property, it's all top side.
All right. When deciding to do a JV, obviously you two are partners. What do you take into account mainly?
Time. So we bought a property in D.C., over in 16th Street Heights, probably like 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. And I was just swamped. Like, we were like, you guys are realtors. A lot of you guys, you know what's happening right now. Everyone's like pulling at you. And I just didn't have time to analyze, swallow, and get the deal, push the deal to the finish line. So for me, it was very important. And I had to be very clear with Willie. I was like, look, man, you have to push this deal through. Like, you're really, literally going to have to, like, handhold me through the deal. I just don't have time. So, you know, when we're JVing on deals, it's really, we want to make sure that both people have a comfort zone. You know, we want to make sure that the numbers work out. Worst case scenario, we're always looking at worst case scenario. And there are deals that where we've lost money, you know. Not much, but where we lost money, we're okay with that. You know, that's no reason for us to sever a relationship or to, you know, not try again. But you know, for us, I think it's really important for us to both feel comfortable with the deal and feel comfortable pushing the deal through the finish line, doing the renovations, and getting it back to the market or getting it back into your buy hold portfolio.
Right. And that was one we had to take down less than a week. So real crunch there. So you got to be ready for, you know, being prepared, everything in place to be prepared to react that quickly if it's a good opportunity. Makes sense, and like you said, being able to have the conversation about timelines and being able to make a decision, what's a good basis, and understanding where each other's comfort level are, and what do you need to see in terms of being comfortable with the property, especially to react that quickly. So I think that pushes both being able to establish what was important to us right away.
All right, segue to my next question. When you do lose money, what's your mental approach?
It was his fault.
You did say that out.
I mean, you're going to win some, you're going to lose some. You know, I've seen a lot of investors get, like, creamed in the market where they can't go buy another one. So we lose $5,000, $10,000 on a property, and, you know, it's easier when you're splitting it up, you know, when you're splitting up the losses, because you're also splitting up the gains. It doesn't, you know, it's just a lesson learned. You know, it's a lesson learned. You know, I don't think we look at it as being, you know, anyone's fault. It's just, you know, we just didn't execute or didn't get as good of a deal or the market shifted.
Yeah, I think time the market shift on you. At the same time as you look at a gain, even if you have a good project successful, you made a good gain, but you know, there's probably things you could have done to make even more. You know, could make mistakes, done more things more efficiently. So in my mind, that's the same as losing too, if you're leaving money, leaving behind. But like I said, you got to be able to stomach both sides of that equation and, you know, manage your risk from a worse side or worse, the worst side of that equation of how bad could it be on any particular deal. So you got to be willing to stomach that.
All right, last question. What is the funniest situation you dealt with in real estate investing?
Oh, my money back.
Funniest situation in real estate investing. Bought a, well, this was about hold. I bought a property from an owner who had a tenant in the property, and the tenant wasn't happy about getting out of the property. Now, Virginia landlord rules and DC landlord rules are very different. So at real estate investing, like that's 101. Like make, if you're buying and holding in DC, it's very different than buying and holding in Virginia. So the tenant wasn't happy about moving out, so we gave her the eviction notice. And you know, in Virginia, like the sheriff comes and drops, the eviction notice is on like the door, they tape it, you can't miss it. So we show up with my contractor, and we start knocking on the door, and her and her kids are sitting there eating cereal. Like, literally, like, eating cereal. It's eviction day. Like, I've already gone through the process, they're eating cereal. So I'm like, man, she's...
What kind of cereal?
I don't remember. But she was playing me. So...
Could have been good for eviction day.
So the way Virginia works is they give you a certain amount of time. So they say, okay, look, you know, you can change the lock, but you've got, like, 24 or 48 hours to get out of the property. So I came back to the property, and luckily I had my contractor with me, and you know, we changed the lock, we opened the door. I was planning on having them do the walkthrough so we can get, you know, what stuff was going on. And we come into the property and we hear like a ching 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 ching. And he's an old country dude, right? Mm-hmm. So he like, man, something don't like sound right. By the time we got out the door, it was a pit bull the tenant left. Pit bulls don't bark. Coming down the stairs at us, and I, by the hair of our chinny chin chin, we got out. And it wasn't funny. It wasn't funny, but it was definitely, it was certainly a lesson learned for sure.
I guess the only one I have, I don't know if anyone's rented out to Section 8. Great source, you know, checks come. But I think it depends on the type of property you have. Single family or townhouse that requires additional maintenance and upkeep, you know, yard, et cetera, make sure that they have the funds to support those activities. So I thought I'd done my due diligence. This is just a condo. There's really nothing to break but the appliances. So I go over there for a maintenance or something, and I go in the kitchen, and this place was newly renovated, and I go in the kitchen, and the light fixture is just literally a bulb hanging down, one bulb. And I said, what happened to the nice light fixture that was up in the kitchen? Oh, you know, those bulbs are like $6 a piece. Couldn't afford to get new bulbs. So you just took it down, hang a bulb up. Okay, I got to understand things happen. Yeah, not judging you, what have you. A few months later, go moving out of the property, cleared off the place. I go in there. I actually had my wife go ahead because I couldn't make it there in time to go inspect the property and sure it was done. Tenant was on the way out the door, and I come inside. I'm like, come outside. And of course, I see in the back of the car my light fixture. Yeah. Sitting in the truck. I said, hold on a second. What you, oh, you want? Do I want it back? This light bulb hanging the ceiling, so you never know. I gave it back to me. But, you know, you never know. Always something.
Excellent. Give it up for these two gentlemen. Open up for a couple. Jimmy will ask the first questions. We'll open up for a couple questions. Do you have a question?
Sure, since you asked. You mentioned earlier about tenants having bad credit. So picking the right tenant and taking your time to do that. But you said you've gotten a flood of people that have bad credit. So what are some of the other factors that you use in judging or determining a tenant outside of credit?
Well, there's the monthly gross income. So obviously you want to look at that. You want to assume that 30% of their grossly monthly income is being used for rent. And use that as a basis to make, do they make enough each month to cover the rent and other expenses that they may have. The credit, you do a credit check, I mean, seeing the gamut of all types of payments they have. And if you don't do a credit check, I mean, you got to pay a fee to do that. But you'll see that in the long list of creditors, you know, you may be last to get paid. It's amazing that they'll make sure the payment stays on, but they won't pay the rent. So it's just looking at that monthly cash flow, making sure that you're not putting them in a position where they're uncomfortable being able to make the rent. So I think you become a part of that equation. And then it's a matter of being consistent of, you know, applying late fees. Sometimes you want to be lean, you want to give them, you know, give them a little break. Oh, it's late, things happen. We understand. You got hit by a car this month. Literally, I've had that that excuse. So you be lean to an extent. Then you get to the point where, you know, that eviction notice you put on the door, you know, you give a grace period to the 5th. On the 6th, that paper's coming. And when they know that, you actually get your money, believe it or not. Not that you're being callous, but you got to be comfortable with, you know, this is a business transaction. Make sure you treat it as such.
For me, it's job history. So I look at three components. I look at job history. I look at previous landlord, like where they stayed, if they made any late payments on the property that they're currently renting, and then credit. So if I can get two of those three, then I'll look at them a little bit more seriously. Obviously, you want the trifecta, but you know, you got to understand the price point of what you're renting. So if you're renting a property that's $1,500 or $1,600, it's probably a reason they're renting that property at that price. So you kind of got to understand the type of demographic. Like, you could be in an area. I mean, you know, let's say Prince George's. You know, if you're in Capitol Heights. You know, are you going to get someone who's got great income, great credit score, and a phenomenal job? Is that likely? Same thing in like Dale City. You know, as part of the Dale City that I know, you're not going to get that. And if you do get that, that's like a unicorn. That's my favorite word.
Yep, unicorn.
But you just kind of got to feel it out. You know, I've gone to visit tenants' properties where they currently rent. So do a surprise visit. If I've got a gut feeling that they're good and I just need a little bit more confirmation and I've got their, you know, their application, I'll just call them up and say, hey, how you doing? I was in the neighborhood. I got to drop off some papers to you. You know, I just want to put a face to a name. You know, just knock on their door and see how they live.
All right. Question for Allen. When you do JVs, really, are you the agent on the deal?
I'm not worried about the 3%. If I'm going to make $30,000, you know, I'm not really like, I think a lot of agents get caught up on the commission.
Well, the reason why I ask is that negotiating is a tool to lower the price.
Like I said, I don't, like, for me, it's all about bottom line net to the seller. So for me, I'm not worried about what commission I get on either side of the deal. I just want us to be able to make money. So I would say probably 80% of the deals, 90% of the deals I purchase, I'm not the agent. You know, or I'll have the listing agent write it for me. Because if I'm getting a good deal, sometimes listing agents tend to get deals done quicker when they're on both sides of the deal. So I'll give them, I'll say, look, you take the 3%. Just give, you know, write it up. Because it's incentive for the listing agent, right? They're getting 6%. They get to represent me. I'm a very easy cash. I'm an easy cash buyer.
One more question. Well, two more. Go ahead.
Have you attempted to get referrals, references of previous jobs from your contractors before you jump ship, change over, try a new one? Actually, go visit a job, see how well they've done it.
Absolutely right. Yeah, especially depending on the value of the renovation you're doing. Yeah, absolutely.
How receptive are contractors to responding to that?
If they're not, then you know there's not the one for you.
Yeah. And you know, I think some of the best, like, hidden sources where I found good contractors are new home build sites. You know, custom builders. You know, who build maybe like, you know, 5 or 6 homes a year. You know, I oftentimes ask them who they use for framing, or who they use for painting, or who they use, you know, for as their plumber.
Mm-hmm. My question was, when you purchased your initial homes and you said you all bought 4 and 4 in your own names, at what point do you structure it out? When do you create the partnership and the partnership of purchasing the home?
or the buy and hold or the buy flip, the investment properties, at what point do you did you? Or do you still buy them in your name? Do you buy the properties as an investor? Do you buy them in your name?
So the working with the bank, they allow us to buy it as an LLC.
Oh,
the only reason they allow us to buy it as an LLC is because our LLC files taxes and shows income.
Okay, right.
So, you know, we've been able to go to them, and community banks look at you as a holistic person as well as, you know, like a Bank of America just looks at your what, W-9 or 10, whatever it is. I've been out of it so far. But they look at us like holistically, so we're able to purchase properties, you know, in our LLC. Traditional banks aren't going to let you do that. They're not going to let you buy it as an LLC because it's too much risk for them.
Unless you have assets in the LLC. If you can, you got the cash to buy one, but you're not going to be able to mortgage it in the LLC's name unless you have a history of doing that.
A history, like, you know, like 4 or 5 years of history.
Okay.
So it's very important if you do want to start to buy properties in the LLCs, for you to start creating, you know, showing income in the LLC. Making sure that you file your taxes properly on your LLC. Because when you go to the bank, you know, then you can say, okay, this is the entity that's been making money for 3 or 4 years.
And it's not just, if you got a bank account in your LLC, it's not just a checking account, but does your LLC have a savings account? They'll look at how long that money stays in there in terms of your stability and being able to pay back the loan.
So one more question over here.
So how do you guys find the properties that aren't kind of what I would consider retail or listed with another agent? I think you had already, in one of your responses, you had mentioned you sent out a letter, and that's how you got that. So I've heard that strategy before, but is there any other databases that you guys might use other than like tax records or anything like that? If you see a vacant property, you just say, take down the address, and what do you do from there, you know, to find the owner, I should say?
Groups like this. You can find properties. I mean, I think what we have to understand is there are plenty of properties to go around. So we have to understand is, and that's why we brought this group together. You know, there are agents in Maryland who are going to run across deals in Virginia that they just aren't going to take down. They're like, look, you know, I just want to find someone who's, you know, who can take this deal down. And the same thing here. We can find a deal in Maryland, and I'm like, look, this is way out of my scope. Who do you know? Do you want to buy it? I think networking is vital. And then you kind of attract what you are. So if you are an investor, you got to start claiming that you're an investor. So you got to have those investor eyes on at all times, even as an agent. And that's sometimes like, I'm speaking to agents because 75% of the people have some type of license. I think we get so caught up on the day-to-day, I want to make commission, that our eyes aren't tuned towards being investors. And I can't tell you how many deals that I've probably passed on because I'm not consistently looking in the MLS. I'm not consistently just throwing out lowball offers on properties that have been sitting on the market for 225 days. Mm-hmm. And just because I'm scared, I got a limiting belief that I just don't want to have a conversation with the realtor. I mean, you know, it's like we got to sometimes get out of our own head. And I've been investing for a long time, and I still get in my own head. You know, because it takes time to write the offer. It takes time to have the conversation. Well, how do you know that if you throw 100 out that 4 or 5 might stick that year? 4 or 5 stick, and you make $30,000 on each?
Just got one question.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead. No, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead. All right. Earlier you had spoke about when you first started, you bought a property as your primary residence. It's kind of a multi-part question, but my first question was, how did you learn, and how did you decide, well, let me back up. How did you learn and how did you decide between the projects you wanted to do yourself, like the work yourself, and work that you wanted to actually outsource? So you have the property, and you mentioned that you did a lot of the work early on. You learned it. Mm-hmm. I'm not that handy,
right. Personally.
So, I mean, was that something, a skill set that you already brought to the table when you moved in, or is that something that you sat down and said, this seems like something I can learn? This seems smarter for me to hire somebody to do the work.
Actually, a little bit of all three of those. So, obviously, I had skills painting, doing, you know, minor touch-up projects like that. First place I wanted to redo the kitchen floor, so my dad taught me how to tile the floor. And then, you know, as you bust holes, the more you learn how to patch up holes, so you learn how to do drugs. And that's just good. The more you do it, the better you get.
Right.
And then water foreclosure that Alan sold me and got it at such a low price point that I could take 3 months to finish the rehab project. And so I wasn't as pressed to get it done in a month. And so that's why I love her. My wife and I took the summer. And rehab. So I ended up gutting all the bathrooms, done all the tile work, all the painting. Even she and I went through and changed every electrical outlet. And so taught her how to do that, all the switches. Any major plumbing, I got something to outsource. I can install toilets, I can do the faucets. Faucets are a pain in the rear. And so, you know, realize that I can spend an hour doing it, I guess I'm gonna have to do it in 15 minutes. And so sometimes you gotta make those trade-offs. Come bang these out while I do something else. Just landscaping outside, make sure if you don't. One of the things I do is I like to make sure the outside of properties is just attractive on the inside. And so sometimes I'll get that done first so that they start to get some attention outside. By the time I finish the inside, you know, they're lining up and ready to come in and see the inside. So don't neglect the outside, wait till last. Depending on the season as well, but you can do that up front and make sure that's maintained. That'll get people inside to do it.
So I think the benefit, and I want to I don't know if you even remember. So I'm like you. I'm not handy. You know, I'm great at outsourcing. Like, I'm really good at outsourcing. But the problem with a guy like me is that I don't have boots on the ground. So I'm not talking to neighbors as often. So I'm just an investor showing up with my suit on. And, you know, they don't like that. Like, people in neighborhoods aren't like that. I'm not their favorite guy. But the benefit that happened to Willie is Willie was working at that foreclosure I sold you. And then neighbors started talking, and he ended up buying another property, like down the block. And I'm quite sure he wouldn't have got that deal had he not been there and being the Mr. Nice Guy and doing all the things at the property. So there's a fine line between, you know, being there and being, you know, at least a little handy and being a guy who can talk to neighbors and being a guy who can, you know, kind of smoosh some people. Because he ended up getting another rental property that probably, I think you bought, it wasn't even that much more expensive than the property I sold you, right?
Nah, I think I got it for $7,000 a month. And it was already, didn't have to do much to it.
And then the second question was, when you were buying your first property with an investment mindset, what factors were you evaluating and when you were thinking about where you want to live, what type of property you wanted, stuff like that, because I guess the mentality I would think would be a little different since you're now buying more as an investment, as something like, I just want to live here.
Right. Are you single?
I am.
You no kids?
No kids.
You can live
so
in
I'm trying to, yeah.
You literally, and you going to
buy? No, not right now.
You should be buying, the best advice that I have for you is you need to be buying and moving up every 2 years. You need, because number one thing you can do is you can buy with very little money down. So you should be buying and holding and moving up every 2 years and then pulling equity off of those properties, going to a bank, pulling equities off of that properties. Even if you don't use the equity, you got available cash. Mm-hmm. Hindsight 2020, my younger self, that's what I would have done.
Okay.
Straight at the age of 22, I would have bought a property, FHA, or some very little money down, something that needed some elbow grease. I would, instead of putting, you know, some more money down, I would have just taken that money, revamped the kitchen. You got some experience, you know, it's probably, you know, it's every 2 years. Think about that. How old are you now?
24.
24, 26, 2, 28, 3, 20, I mean, you could just keep going on. You know, by the time you're, you know, 35, you know, you got properties where you didn't, you know, you didn't put a whole lot of down payment down.
Okay.
Sam.
Oh, that was pretty much the question he asked in the second part. But another question I had, let's say for someone that's starting out, are you going to initially focus on that cash flow initially? I know you mentioned earlier, don't be greedy. But is that cash flow initially something that you should focus on, or should you be thinking from a long-term perspective?
I say for me, I've been able to balance both. So you definitely need cash to do more deals. So if you're short on cash, you might have to stack up a few flips instead of cash so you can buy that buy hole and have a little more more runway there. You know, it's been to the point where we've been doing flips simultaneously, but I always make sure I buy another rental of NY1 every year at least.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you can keep that tandem and balance that out, that's been good for a long-term wealth strategy, but also bringing cash in to help finance and support other things that you want to do.
Because Alan mentioned, obviously, if you're single, but most probably not everyone in here is single. So what's the strategy in that aspect? The same kind of question. If you should you be thinking more just holding, like cash flow, I need the property that has cash flow, or I'm not going to make that much money, but in a couple of years, I may have a little bit of cash flow coming in.
I think cash flow is always good. I think building assets is always good. You know, so if you can move out of a property that you currently live in, mm-hmm. and you can cash flow, you know, $200-$400 a month, I think that's a good investment. I mean, think about how much you put into the property. You know, you probably put, what, $10,000 in, $12,000 in. You know, if you can get $300 a month, that's good money. You know, and over time, it's going to build up. And I think a lot of the attractiveness that John Marshall had with us is that we have combined, what, 14, 15 buy holds? 14 buy holds. So when we went to them and sat down and talked to them, it was, you know, they like the stability.
And like something they could go take if we default.
Yeah, exactly.
But, no, if you do have a partner, you know, a spouse, what have you, they got to be willing to stomach that with you. If they don't have the same risk tolerance, you got to make sure they're comfortable with it. And so, you want to spend what on what? So we had those conversations.
Where's the heart?
Huh? I think after the first deal or two, I'm like, hey, this is, you know, a smaller level investment. You know, the first couple you do it at a certain range that she's comfortable with. And, you know, as you get a positive return, they start to see, like, oh, this could actually work. And, you know, you still get the question of, all right, have you done your analysis? Does this make sense? But the more you do it, you show that you're not just doing it off a whim. They become comfortable with that process. And obviously, if it's fruitful, they're definitely on your team at that point.
I bought my first properties in my wife's name, and she didn't even know. It was a good deal. It was a great deal. In hindsight, 2020, she's like, damn, we should have bought more. But I think my dad sometimes says that, you know, my mom would. Had he not listened to my mom, he would have held every property that he owned. And I think he was up to like 60. Mm-hmm. And now he's down to 40 now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you got to have, if you have the long-term sight of where you want to go, sometimes the people aren't going to come with you there. But at the end, they're going to be like eating steak with you or, you know, enjoying whatever mm-hmm. lifestyle that you want to have. So you got to be committed to that.
One more, and we got to wrap.
Thank you. What are your thoughts on purchasing multiple rental properties in the same community?
I like it. Because you know that I've known you for a long time. I know what you're thinking about. I like it because you can manage them all in one place. And, you know, you really have a feel on what you're doing. So, you know, even though you have a buy hold, you still got to drive there. So if you can drive by and check out two of your properties at one time, I love that. And that's why I try not to buy properties that are that are, you know, more than 10 miles away from my property, from where I live.
Yeah, I was never said at first, but I have four that two are right next, close to each other, you know, one, you know, kind of back, piggyback to one another. But you're right, in terms of maintenance, it's easy to get both of them. You know the area, you know what the rent is for. I do have a rental property in Philadelphia, and, you know, I probably wouldn't suggest doing something out of state that you can't get to quickly. You know, but after doing my due diligence there, it's in a high rise condo. There is maintenance people on site so they can take care of stuff in the building. But, you know, got that through a friend referral in terms of, you know, building was converted onto condos, you get what got in the market. This is one of my early on investments back in 2004, 2005. So definitely had cash here, was willing to take the risk, and it had a tenant in it. So, you know, I lowered the risk profile, but over time was able to. Upgraded and get higher rents, and I've been very fortunate. Got another investor who owns units in the building who rents units out to rotating nurses and doctors in UPenn and Drexel, so right in Center City. So he sublets it, you know, every 6 months, and it's furnished. And I said, hey, it's fine with me. Do what you want to do. All the checks come here. You can rent charge it for whatever you want. And that's been going 7 years strong so far. So hopefully that
excellent. Thank you for your questions. Now we're going to have a quick word from my sponsor, Kevin.
So when JC reached out to me and asked me to sponsor this event, first of all, I want to come along because the topic I'm interested in, and I don't know about you guys, but it really sparked my interest today. But also, I believe we can be a good resource. Hunter the Junk can be a good resource for you as a real estate agent and as an investor. So what we do is we go on commercial or residential properties to pretty much remove anything and everything. The only things we don't take are hazardous chemicals. But we do have a resource for getting rid of those items as well. So I have some business cards up here and information if you guys do want that resource, I'll be happy to provide it to you.